slip you some boogie. We will it! For the Fringe FM, coming at you live from the middle of nowhere, the center of everywhere, here once again to give you yet another scrumptious dose of conversational boogie. This is, wait for it, Shift Habits. Ba-da-boop. Do follow us on Twitter at Shift Happens Pod. You can follow me, Gigi, over at GigiRabbit1, and we're all over Instagram and Facebook and all that good stuff. Just go to shifthappensradio.com. We've got all of our links and all of that bullshit over there. And hey, what's happening, Pat? And you know what, Pat? I've got to say, you are 100% correct. I am indeed wearing nothing but a Justin Bieber thong and headphones. As always, as is tradition here on Shift Happens. Now, Brad is out traveling with the family and doing, holiday stuff. So he's not going to be here tonight. But doubling as my sidekick for the intro, as well as the guest for the evening... That's right. There's none other than JewPro, a.k.a. Jewish Producer, a.k.a. Joe, a.k.a. JP from the Reperception Podcast. You can follow his podcast over there at reperception.net. What's happening, my friend? Long time no talk.
What is going on? So stoked to be back. And don't worry, people, if you missed the Beaver Moon Eclipse, which was November 25th, a couple days ago. Fear not. Because there is another, I think it's a solar eclipse coming up. So, don't worry, December 14th. Yeah, it's a total solar eclipse, which is very rare. Don't ask me what a beaver moon eclipse is. Maybe you know, Gigi.
Oh, I thought that meant that Maya was going to flash us on the next Anti-Ed podcast. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, you know, like a full beaver.
That could still happen.
that could easily still happen, absolutely. But you know what's happening on December 21st?
I do. There's a whole bunch of stuff going on, but that is even a bigger news, obviously, that the grand or great conjunction, Jupiter and Saturn, you know, this hasn't happened in some, I think, over 650 years.
Yeah, I think it was the 1200s, somewhere around there, was the last time it happened. And it's really interesting because if you think about...
Quite a cycle.
If you think about all of the planets that have some sort of historical, religious, spiritual connection with the Earth, typically those are usually Jupiter and Saturn. Sometimes you get Mars, but you never hear about Neptune, right? You never hear about Uranus. Well, you might hear about mine, but you don't hear about the planet. When it comes to these, these old ancient traditions, it's all about Saturn and Jupiter and a little bit of Mars here and there, and a little bit of Venus, right? But
some of the astrologers out there, excuse me, some of those astrologers though really get into the Neptune conjunctions and returns and pathways along with Uranus, not mine. Yeah. But it's those do kind of make the grade and are very, very important for astrological purposes. And I think what everything that's going on up there is kind of telecasted here on our Earth. When we think about it, these cycles are so long and so important, but they do happen. And this one's crazy, happening at just kind of like, you know, as we're trying to wrap up this really funky year. It's just craziness, dude.
Yeah. And you know what? Speaking of craziness, actually, no, I'm going to save that for a little bit. And also, I'm going to save that for a little bit, too. And I'm going to save that point for a little bit, too. How about that? Three out of my four notes I'm saving for later.
Nice.
The only other thing I had written down was, I don't really give a shift. I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to go there tonight. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you guys had a great, so this, you know, the first show since Thanksgiving, was just a mere yesterday. And I hope you guys had a great Turkey Day. And I want to know from the audience, what was the most delicious edible item that was made available to you on Turkey Day? Let me know in either chat room, either in Spreaker or over there at the Fringe FM Discord. Which also, by the way, I'm not sure why I'm wasting my breath telling you guys this, since you're already listening, and those who can't are the one that I'm trying to tell this to. Either way, the Fringe FM website is under construction right now. So if you have to, you know, if you're planning on switching over to there because you have to run to the store or something, yeah, the website is down, but rest assured, the Fringe FM app, both available for iPhone and Android, is still available and working, and all the other half a million platforms that were syndicated through the Fringe FM, like TalkStream Live and TuneIn and Radio Garden, and I think there's one called Radio 4. I don't even know what they all are, but there's a lot of them, and we're, it's all there under the Fringe FM in case you have to switch. If you got to drive to the store and want to switch to an app, there you go. But the website is down. And buttermilk biscuits, says Mike. And
nice.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, man. There's biscuits, and then there's buttermilk biscuits. And then there's biscuits with butter, or there's biscuits with honey butter. You see what I'm saying, folks? Do you see what I'm saying, folks? Honey butter on your biscuit. Get out of here with that regular-ass butter. We need that honey butter, son. I mean, don't get me wrong. Regular butter's good, too. But, man, just throw some honey in there. You'll be surprised. And so how about this? So get a load of this, JP.
Yep.
Get a load of that, too. But so our Instagram account, not the Shift Happens Instagram account, but this other show I do on Twitch called the Anti-Ed 2 podcast. We have,
I heard about it. Yeah, I heard it's great.
No, it's terrible. But our Instagram podcast, oh no, it's a lot of fun. I've been having so much fun, and man, we're doing like 4 or 5 shows a week over there. But our Instagram account got banned, or temporarily banned. And here's the crazy thing is, it was after a post that was just like all of our posts. It was basically like, hey, do you want to laugh? Well, then come watch this. And we posted a link. No cussing, nothing inappropriate, just a screenshot of the podcast. And that's it. And we all post it, you know, everybody that's involved in there, we all post it from the exact same post, copy and pasted to my other personal account. But that didn't get blocked. But of course, our Anti-Ed 2 account that has just been building up momentum along with the channel, like, couldn't have been worse timing for the account. Like, talk about, I mean, Instagram really ducked down and punched us right in the nads as far as the timing when it comes to, like, man, right when our following was building. I mean, it's still building. It's just that Instagram was our number one means of I guess what I'm getting at is, because Instagram is now owned by Facebook, which means that Google owns it. And ever since that happened, they've been a little wonky with their algorithms. And I've got to say, now listen, if I like flashed the camera and said F you and then posted that, you know, I could understand. But all we're doing is just saying, hey, do you want to laugh? Click here. That's it. That's it. And they don't give you a reason. They don't give you an explanation. In fact, they don't even have tech support. They don't have customer support. You just have to wait for 2 weeks with no explanation until I can't even like a post from that account. And so I guess what I'm trying to say is F you, Instagram. F you. And yeah, that's what a great positive way to start the show here at Shift Happens.
Sick of that.
Seriously though, what the hell, man? What the hell? And have you guys ever been blocked on Instagram? If you have, let me know. I'd love to know who else has been blocked on Instagram. By the way, Pat the Elf Man, thanks for the pictures of the shirt, dude. If it's okay with you, especially both of those images. We would love to use those on the website. Let me know if you're down, my brother, because those, especially the one where you split your beard there. That's epic right there.
I'm just going to say this. I'm sad that Brad Harris couldn't join us tonight.
Yeah, that's two shows in a row where, you know, life just, you know, life is unpredictable. And sometimes, well, this was pretty predictable. He was going to take this one off anyway. But yeah, last week, you know, just stuff comes up. But rest assured, Brad is still Brad, and he's still our associate producer, and he's still our guy.
I miss my homie, Brad Harris. Come back soon, dude.
Yeah, I'm sure that he'll be back Bailey? Next week. And speaking of next week, what's the date? Do you know what next Friday is? What's the date of that? Let's see. Well, I know it. Well, it's not the 11th, right? Obviously. Okay, anyway.
No.
We got a very surprise special guest for you guys on December 11th that I'm very excited about. And also Michael Paul Masters, who's been a pretty up-and-coming dude as far as the conference scene and giving lectures at the likes of Contact in the Desert and the UFO Congress. I just heard him on Jimmy's show the other month. And he's starting to get out there. And I met him a couple years ago. And we've been meaning to get him on this whole time. And we just never got around to it. So,
Next week is the 4th, by the way. Thank you, Catalina.
Okay, the 4th. Yeah, I'm not sure what... I would have to check with Brad. I'm not sure who we have booked for the 4th. But Michael Paul Masters will be coming on the week after the 11th. And we got some great shows lined up for you guys. That is for damn sure. And let's see. I'm trying to keep up with the chat room, but I can't do... By the way, Maya, whenever you tune in, yes, we actually do need an intern. So if you're serious about that, hit us up. And especially a chat room manager. That would be nice. Some sort of filter for the chat room. Not a filter, just... I just can't read everything all the time. But anyway, with that, so here's...
By the way, Gigi, and real quick, what happened? I'm sorry to admit this, but I didn't hear the show you did with the guys or guy from Chumbawamba. How did that turn out? And what was that all? How'd it go?
Oh, the show was absolutely... It was one of the best shows we ever did until after he left the last 10 minutes. I had a little too much to drink, and I started being stupid for 10 minutes. So I kind of like, dude, it was the best show ever, and then after he left, I just bombed for like 10 minutes. Just the hardest bombing you can imagine. Awesome. But rest assured, I have cut that part out, so if you go and listen to the replay, you won't hear it. Ha-ha! You see how that works, folks?
Smart.
Yeah. There you go. But yeah, that was awesome, man. And in fact, he should be getting his Shift Happens shirt any day now. And he said he's going to take some photos and do that for us. So thanks, Dambert. Really do appreciate you, buddy. And but one thing I wanted to bring up, JP, especially because you're out there in the valley. Well, and by the valley, I mean the San Fernando Valley, out there in Los Angeles, basically. And man, like you know, I was just about to move back to North Hollywood, and then last minute, it just makes more sense for me to move back to Austin right now. But to add on top of that reasoning, I just heard about this, curfew that they have. You can't be out past 10 p.m. and you can't be out any earlier than 5 a.m. And now when people start talking about, conspiracy theories about this whole COVID situation, this is one of those examples that I can understand why they might start thinking outside the box, is because what the hell are you guys doing? What does that mean? Oh, so I can't catch COVID between the hours of 10 and 5 a.m.? Really? Oh, and I'm totally safe during the day? Like, what's the point of that? What is the point of that rule? Think about that, ladies and gentlemen. What? That's like if we had a hurricane that was going to last for 3 days and they said, oh, you can go outside between 5 and 10, but not any other time. Well, why not? It's still a hurricane, isn't it? It doesn't make any sense. And then on top of that, there's even more sanctions that have been put down in the county of in the LA County specifically, which actually Dave, I just gave it away. Somebody is going to be calling in later during the show. Man, really?
You suck at keeping secrets.
I suck. And
you know, Gavin Newsom's been flexing his muscles, and he's one of my least favorite politicians of all time. Gigi, I'm going to tell you, he's like maybe my top three, and I've seen a whole lot of politicians in my time. He is the worst. I can't stand the guy, and he's been
going
outside the bounds of the Constitution.
Yeah.
And he's been getting sued left and right. And I will just say this about this weekend. I think there's an article out there too. And I wish the show was more visual, like the show you have tomorrow, but because I can even find this article, but there were four or five sheriffs that came out publicly as saying they weren't going to, they weren't going to exercise this kind of enforcement. And so, you know, you get a dumb mandate like that. It's not really a mandate, but it is what it is. And first of all, you know, does this so-called virus take a break? You know, does it sleep when we sleep? Like, I don't get that. But it's not being enforced. And but it's just silly. It just goes along with so much of the silliness and the crazy coded articles and stories we get. It's just part of the puzzle. It's just really ridiculous. We're headed for some weird times, dude.
Yeah, and it just all goes to show, like who actually do you know how many people were involved in making that an actual policy? Like, oh, the boogeyman is only out there at night, right? Like, people actually passed that stuff. And so you gotta wonder. It's obvious they're obviously not trying to protect us for COVID, because certainly they're not that stupid. Certainly they don't actually think that that's going to do anything at all, right? There's no way they think that. And if they do, then folks, we're in some real trouble. But let's take a step back. Nobody's actually that stupid. So why else do they want people to not be outside from 10 to 5 a.m.? That's where the real mystery is. What's the real reason behind that? Because it's obviously not protecting people from COVID.
You know, it's a road we could go down, and through the night, I'm sure I'll drop some points here and there, but it's a windy road. And in my view, it's an economic virus. It has nothing to do with getting sick and, you know, falling over. This is an economic virus, and the mask has been the corporate veil. And there's so much that goes along with this, man. And everybody seems to – I hate to even say my points of view sometimes. I'm sorry to say that. But right now isn't the time to start picking fights with people. Everybody seems to have a different view. And I haven't really – it seems like I haven't really met two people with the exact same points of view. There's all these – variables that people keep mixing up into their beliefs. And by the time I kind of draw a conclusion on what this person's about, I figure out, wow, they're very different from how the next person's going to think, I'm sure. And I think somebody, Russ, said it was all fuckery. Excuse the language, dude.
All right. I'll let you get away with that one.
Damn you, Russ, you got me busted. But yeah, I agree. It's all kind of shenanigans, and it's pretty shifty.
Very shifty. And speaking of shifty, you know, so we're going to take our first break a little bit early, but before we do, you know, we like to have a good time here on Shift Happens, right, folks? And we always do. We try to keep it positive, but unfortunately, I do have some bad news. Well, especially for me. And something that there's just no way I can do a show, without mentioning this. So since our last show last Friday, one of the coolest people I've ever met in my life, I have spent so much time with this person. man, my friend Daniel Dowd, very tragically and in just such a gruesome way, it's such an unnecessary gruesome way, passed away last week. And you know what? I'm not even going to downplay this, because here's the thing. It seems like ever since I turned 30 a couple of years ago, that all of a sudden just a bunch of my friends just started dying. But here's the thing, is most of those are either unintentionally self-inflicted or intentionally self-inflicted or disease-related or accidents, right? That covers all of them. But never have I had such a close friend murdered out of cold blood and in such a disgusting, grotesque way. That really just, it blows my mind. And here's the other thing too, is Daniel Dowd, he was down to earth and cool as hell for 100% of the time that he was on this planet. I can't even, we grew up skateboarding, even though he was 5 years younger than me, which if you think about it, you know, when I'm 18 and he's 13, right? That's a much bigger difference between 32 and 37, right? Or 28 and 32 in this case. You know, that 4 or 5 year difference is a lot bigger when you're younger. And he proved, he was that young Grom that came in. We both rode for the same sponsors and we spent countless hours filming on road trips and just hanging out. And I even if I try my hardest, I cannot think of a single moment where he was even annoying, much less piss me off, ever. He is just the coolest dude ever. And it's just so unfortunate. Let me put it this way. If there were only one person who did not deserve that fate, it was my friend, Daniel Dowd. And so with that, ladies and gentlemen, if you have ever listened to a single thing I've ever said, I want you to listen to me right now. I want you all to raise your glass or raise your food. Even if you don't have glass or food, just raise an object. It could be a toothpick or a hair trimmer or a PlayStation controller. Everybody hold something up with me right now. Everyone listening, hold something up right now as we toast to my friend Daniel Dowd. Rest in peace, my friend, and I will see you at your funeral, my buddy. Cheers to Daniel Dowd. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and take our next our first commercial break, rather, and we'll be back here in just a few short minutely minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for The Fringe FM. I am your host, Gigi Malth, our associate producer. Well, nope, he's not here, but we are here with JP from the Reperception Podcast, and we'll be back here in just a few short minutes. Don't go anywhere.
Why is it we're not very good with our health regimen until it's too late? We don't put oil in the car until the engine blows up. When the body's out of balance, your health is not so good. Give your body some love. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Try our Life Change Tea, which cleanses you from harmful intruders. A clean colon is one of the ways to bring the body in balance. We also carry organic supplements to help you get where you need to go. So do your body a favor. Log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. You can even visit our sales page to save some dough. Does anybody call money dough anymore? Anyway, if you're looking for short, helpful health tips, go to YouTube and punch in Health Matters Now. That's Health Matters Now. So, log on to GetTheTea.com, shop, get balanced, then learn some cool tips at Health Matters Now. You'll be glad you did. That's GetTheTea.com.
From birth, we have been conditioned to conform to what is normal,
conditioned to adhere to authority, and conditioned to repeat what has been told to us as truth. I'm Ryan Gable, and here at The Secret Teachings Radio, I've interviewed hundreds of great guests and done extensive unique research into subjects that span from the paranormal and the occult to health, philosophy, and history. I personally have no affiliations or agenda, except to use objective critical thinking in my analysis of every subject discussed, to empower myself with information, and hopefully allow you to do the same. If you want to join me, tune into the Secret Teachings radio broadcast, airing live Monday through Friday from midnight to 3 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time on The Fringe FM. For more information, you can visit our website at www.thesecretteachings.info or email me at rdgable@yahoo.com.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy, Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods, 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
Kids, don't drink and park. Accidents cause people. This has been a PSA brought to you by your friends at Shift Happens and The Fringe FM.
Ew, yuck, they're unhealthy and gross. Bugs, I hate bugs. We keep a clean home, but occasionally bugs show up. Well, I found something that is tougher than bugs. Orange Guard. From Contact, it kills bugs. Plus, Orange Guard kills hidden bugs and keeps new bugs away for weeks. I know. I use Orange Guard. Plus, all of the ingredients of Orange Guard are on the FDA generally regarded as safe list. Orange Guard may be used around food, humans, and pets. It promotes a healthier planet, and here's a bonus. Orange Guard cleans where it's sprayed. Plus, it comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee. Orange Guard.
You can get Orange Guard at Ace Hardware. And listen, folks, Orange Guard is tougher than bugs, and it's safe to use. Go to orangeguard.com. That's orangeguard.com.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
Fringe FM. This is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, and joining me tonight is JP from the REIT. You know what? I need to get a new cable here. And joining me tonight is JP from the REIT Perception Podcast. How goes it, my friend?
I don't know if that's code, but we'll get you a new cable. How you doing, everybody?
Oh no, I was just talking to myself live on the air. You know, like I usually do.
Yeah. Nice. I was just reading the board, a little slow on the draw there, but K28 said she was in, or he was in
Idaho. I don't know who this K is, but it's really interesting. This K is in the 818. I'm in the 818. And K was in Idaho. I was recently in Idaho. I have a good friend in Idaho. So is this person either following me or is this just pure coincidence?
No, he's one of the most OG-est of listeners of Shift Happens, and he's heard you on here a million times. He's also checked out the Midnight Blend every time you've been on there. So, so yeah, he knows who you are by now. Yeah,
awesome.
Yeah, awesome. Absolutely.
I love it.
Yeah, and by the way, I don't know if you caught it, JP, but yeah, last week, me and Dave officially announced the at least temporary death of the Midnight Blend.
That's it?
Well, that's it for now. And it's just because, I mean, just like you too, like we all have too much other shift that we're doing. And Saturday nights, it was great while it lasted. We all loved doing it, but, you know.
You would think that Saturday nights would be the best. They're actually not the best night to dedicate to the podcasts. I don't think
they're really not, because most people are. And Russ says the Midnight Blend needs to come back. Well, I'm down anytime. You guys let me know. How about that?
We're trying to run away from it, Russ.
Yeah, I was just the last one standing. That's why I really ended. But me and Dave, and really it was me and Dave. You know, anyway. But yeah, it's done for now because we've all got our own different projects that are taking up our time, and it's just literally not feasible for what we wanted it to be, for it to work. So, but yes, hopefully one day we do. In fact, we do plan on bringing it back in some way, shape, or form, and probably in the same shape and form. In fact, but it just might be a while. And that's all right, because you know what? Dave's doing his show on Twitch now on Saturdays, and I'm also doing Anti-Ed 2 on Saturdays and Mondays and Thursdays and Wednesdays and Fridays as well. And then I'm doing Shift Happens on Fridays. Listen, folks, it's getting crazy. It's getting busy. So that's why the death. It's more like a coma. The Midnight Blend has entered a coma state. And we'll see when it comes back. And yeah, K28. That was my original point. OG listener. Now, I've got a couple. Now, real quick. So, first of all, you know what we're going to do, folks, is we're going to pretty much leave the phone lines open all night tonight. But before we open them, let's see if there's a couple of things we want to get to first. Now, real quick, JP, I know you had a couple of interesting topics that you wanted to bring up tonight. So why don't we just swan dive into one of those?
Well, we actually kind of hit on one. I mean, I really was thinking about kind of getting into some of the ridiculous news stories out there. But, you know, we kind of hit the one with what's going on here in California. And, you know, the whole Thanksgiving thing was very peculiar, and I don't know if you know how many people out there have children, but I've read a lot of articles, and I've heard from other sources as well that the schools are doing a lot of weird things, and I'm not going to sink us too low, Gigi, all right, but I'm just saying the teachers, I think the teachers are going to be asking a lot of the students when they return about Thanksgiving, and you know, in some places where more restrictive than others, shall we say. I've heard rumors of, you know, maybe teachers trying to get information to be able to go and maybe get the parents in trouble or something. So who knows where that's going to lead. I generally take every media sourced news information I get with a very small, tiny grain of salt. I don't put much love or time into those sort of things. Yeah. I actually have more fun calling out, decoding a lot of these news stories and showing by simple use of numerology what the hell's wrong with these stories? And then, of course, we apply our common sense. And I've done shows on the news cycle and how that kind of, well, I'll let that lie, because one day we should probably do a show on the news cycles and how news articles originate. You'd probably be really, you'd have a mind shift if you knew exactly how news is created and how it's put into action, into motion, and distributed, and then how the uses of VNRs attached to these articles or storylines go. And yeah, I've done a real deep dive into that. And if anybody out there knows what I'm talking about and knows the news cycles and how they're done, please call in and share that info and talk about it, because I've found that the more I talked about it, the less I realized people knew. You know, they just see their news. Most people just don't care. You know, I'm trying to raise our levels of awareness from complete apathy to maybe like considering. And anyways, I guess long story short, I've been focused on helping people around me become an observer. And that's a real hard concept for some people. And for me, it's second nature. I'm a good listener. I really enjoy hearing what other people have to say, which is probably why I talk to you, Gigi, because I know you're going to give me a freaking earful. Excuse my language. Damn, yeah. Two times. I'm so sorry. But yeah, you give me an earful, but I like to hear you because you got really good points. But, and I'm not focusing this to you in any way. I'm just saying, in fact, I really focused it with a podcast partner of mine. And, you know, it really worked. Yeah, Gigi, you need a bleep button. I know, I know. He does.
Hey, as long as I'm not the one saying it, I can only get in so much trouble. But now that I say that, I'm probably going to get in more trouble now. So,
the message is being observed.
Yeah, you make a good point, but I've got to say, I feel like, especially most of our core audience, I think they are aware of exactly what you're talking about. And I think that's what brings us together is, you know, we're like-minded folks in that sense. And, yeah, not just a grain of salt. Sometimes you got to take it with a whole gallop of salt. And, yes. you know, and you know who really spoke so well and really broke it down exactly where the news comes from and who is in charge, not to mention international news that makes our American channels is all controlled from one person at one desk for all of the major corporations, including Viacom and Disney. And it's all decided by one person. And in all those six corporate, it used to be seven, now it's down to six corporations that own every single type of mainstream public forms of news, whether it's magazines, newspapers, cable networks, the cable networks, YouTube channels, what have you. It's all the same shift.
I'd probably take it a step further and say we're down to two and possibly even one at this point. All we have are boards of directors that may have opposing views, but I basically think that we are about to become the United States of Taco Bell.
Pretty much. And if there's one company if there's one corporation to really pay attention to that really has their hand in everyone's pocket, and by hand, I mean the whole hand and the whole pocket, is Viacom. Look into Viacom and look at their prosperous, prestigious record of effery and just effery after another. They really,
I don't know about you, Gigi, but they ruined my favorite radio stations that I grew up listening to. When they bought those stations up, they were never the same. They never recovered. Did that happen to you at all?
Not only did that happen, but they also ruined my life, at one point. I mean, now I've got my life back together, but, Viacom was directly responsible for that crazy shift that happened to me the whole artificial intelligence scandal that I was involved with. I've talked about it a million times. No need to go into it here. And plus, I wouldn't anyway. but yeah.
I want to hear about it.
Well, I did a whole show. So Joe Roop from Lighting the Void did a whole, had me on the show. I did a tell-all story about what went down. And then, of course, I got framed for something the next day and went to jail for it. So, which I later got proven innocent. But it was just really interesting. Like, every time I mention that story, something terrible happens to me. Very interesting. Very interesting. And so, yeah, there you go. But, you know, here's what's... Oh, man, I forgot for a second. We can't say certain words. Okay, how can I... Well, anyway, let's just put it this way. One thing that's really been sort of... And I know we've... I'm sure we've talked about this before, JP. Oh, let me make sure nobody's... okay. I'm sure we've talked about this before. And that is... Whoever is really running the show, and by the show, I mean reality. Whoever's in charge of, like, forget about who's in charge of America. Forget about who's in charge of Russia. I'm talking about who's in charge of the UN. You know what I'm saying? Who's in charge of NATO? You know what I'm saying? Like, those people, right? And, hold on one second. Let me take a sip of this Got Hemp Extracts.
Ooh. Nice.
CBD coffee.
Oh, share that.
My coffee's extra strong tonight.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I put an extra dose of CBD in mine as well.
Feels good.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, this coffee is so strong, it's made me drop 2 F-bombs, so I do apologize. Give you one less shot of that espresso, and then I'll be okay.
Yeah, and listen, ladies and gentlemen, if you need more F-bombs dropped by your mouth in your everyday life, go to GotHempExtracts.com, enter the promo code SHIFTHAPPENS, and you will save yourself 10% off of your CBD-infused cold-pressed coffee. See how I did that, JP? Get there while you can status.
It's so good. It's so good, though. You sent me a bag last week, or packet, or whatever, and it's kicking my butt.
Yeah,
look what it's done to me tonight.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. And, but here's the real mystery, though, is when it comes to ancient megalithic sites and what we're told about them growing up, like the pyramids of Egypt, we're told that they're only a few thousand years old. We're told that no civilization was, you know, has existed before the last ice age. But we have, whether it's Göbekli Tepe or, Gudanpoyong or what have you, we have so many examples. There's so much hardcore evidence to the point where Zahi Hawass lost his tenure in his position because he was tried to pretend for so long that it didn't exist. And,
are you joking? Did Hawass finally get booted? I didn't hear this.
Oh, yeah. This was several. Yeah. Basically, what kicked it off was, did you ever see the debate he did with Graham Hancock, or the lack of a debate that didn't happen?
It very well, like the whole scene, the whole surrounding circumstances.
Yeah, so that was kind of like the first domino that fell over in the downfall of Zahi Hawass. And yeah, he lost his all prestigious, great position that he had over Egyptology. And he's just kind of, he's still involved. He still has influence. Let's not be foolish for a second. He's obviously not just going to disappear. He's still in there somewhere, but he doesn't have that official title anymore. But my point is, what is the big deal about hiding the true history of these monuments? Like, for example, I have to do a show every Friday night at 7. If my belief changes from the pyramids being 3,000 years old to being 20,000 years old, well, that's interesting and that's great. But how is that going to affect the fact that I still have to do my show on Friday? You know, like, what's the big... Like, why are they so bent on making sure that we do not know the true history of these megalithic structures? What do you think?
I think we'd be very disappointed to know the truth. I think it's all big... hoax, but that's just me. I mean, there's, again, a lot of
I spent years looking at those stories, Gigi, just like the UFO, information I was always getting my hands into. I was very interested at a young age of UFOs and Art Bell and then, of course, Egypt and Egyptology and Zachariah Sitchin and all these other kind of surrounding pathways to go down and down them all. And I've kind of drawn some conclusions. And, you know, I still think it's a huge, huge industry. And there's still a lot of people that know so much about the history and the work, so-called inner workings of these the pyramids. And I don't know. I just don't buy it. I know it's a letdown for so many people. I don't buy any of it. I think it's all just a big old playground.
Wait, so what do you mean? Now let's narrow it down to the pyramids, for example. When you say you don't buy it, what do you mean exactly about the pyramids that you don't buy?
I don't think they're nearly as old as we're told they are. And I think that they...
Oh, really?
I just think that they were crafted in a way that is probably a lot, whatever's there, has been done. It's been kept a massive mystery on purpose. And I think that the truth of it all would just be very disappointing for a lot of people, but maybe I think maybe I'm wrong, and I'm not an expert in any which way. I've just gone down these roads and looked and read, and it comes down to when I things that are thousands of years old supposedly, like this, or even now with you look at the JFK story, and people still have tons of arguments that doesn't seem settled, right? There's still division, and people can't come to an agreement of what happened. Was there one shooter? Was there two shooters? Was all Oswald a patsy? What happened? And it's still, there's people still fighting about these things. And for my money, when I think these are intentionally designed mysteries for us to really never get a clear answer for. But revelation of method will indeed one day help us figure all this stuff out in a more, enlightened way, I guess.
As soon as we can figure out how the hell they were built. But this is why I like having you on the show, JP, is because you're the only guest that I've ever had on this show in the last 4 years that would have the balls to come out and say something like that. Because
I get my ass kicked by some of these ufologists or Egyptologists, and they know so much they could murder me with all of their books of knowledge that would fall down and rain on me and get me soaking wet. I still maintain that I think that we're being hoaxed.
We're certainly being hoaxed, in whether it's your way or the exact opposite way. Now, real quick, before the audience gets mad at me, I already see some of the comments coming in. Now, let me just say that if I had to bet, I would say that the pyramids are way older than 3,000 years ago. But one thing that nobody ever talks about and nobody ever entertains the idea of is what JP just brought up, and that is, what if they're actually way younger? What if they just built that shift like 200 years ago? Or, when were the pyramids discovered? Like 300 years ago? Like as far as modern, obviously we know about the pyramids forever, for thousands of years. As far as when mainstream archaeology has started looking at it and really trying to figure out what it was, that's only been a few hundred years, right?
Modern Egyptology, archaeology in there, yeah.
And K28 says 100,000 years old. Wow. Well, if there's one thing we can be certain of, is that it's not whether it's early, whether it was made by somebody 400 or 500 years ago. The whole rabbit hole, we have to take a break real quick. But, man, I do love that idea. I know we all like to take the time and look about how old it may be. But... what if we are just being hoaxed? That's another thing. In fact, there's a whole book about this that Micah Hanks from the Grillion Report, or now I think it's just called the Micah Hanks Show, He nice. Turned me on to this book called Skepticism and Historical Knowledge, which I actually have right on the other side of my room right now, that actually IPD in the chat room right now is the one who bought it for me, because it's such a hard book to find, and he found a copy of it and he gave it to me. And the whole point of the book, to summarize it in one very long, shifty sentence, is his whole point is everything that we are taught about human history beyond the date of 1776 is absolute complete horseshit and just 100% fabricated. And he makes a really fascinatingly intriguing argument for that throughout the whole book. It's a pretty short book. It's only a couple hundred pages long. And JP, you would love, man, I might have to send you this copy of this book, because you would really dig what this dude is saying.
What's his name again? I'll write it down.
You know what? I'm gonna grab the book right now. Give me one second. It's right here.
Believe it or not, I actually have a pen in my hand. I'm using old school pen and paper to take a note, if you can believe that.
I know this isn't very professional, but it's okay because I am back already. And so the person who wrote this, which, by the way, this was written by Jack W. Myland, Meiland. The book is called Skepticism and Historical Knowledge. And it's not really... it wasn't originally a book. It was just a paper that he wrote, just a very long paper. And it was so profound that somebody else got the rights to it and published it into a book. But it is so hard to find a copy of this thing. It is unbelievable. And but it's definitely worth a read. And especially if you guys know Micah Hanks, he's basically, even though he is in this community, he is like the skeptic of this community. You know what I mean? Like, he doesn't... you have to have some real hard scientific facts for him to even entertain the idea of anything, right? Well, I wouldn't go that far. But if he's going to actually admit to something, there has to be some real scientific evidence. And so for someone for Micah to recommend this book to me is... that's a powerful statement in itself. And not to mention the fact that IPD is the one that gave it to me makes it even more powerful for many reasons that I cannot explain here. And it's just such a good book, and everyone should read it. And it will really make you wonder, like, oh, yeah, we really do not have a way of knowing if we're being lied the hell to or not. Like, we really don't have a way of knowing.
And I know we're going to break really quick, but I do have a funny quick story I'll tell. And I used to run the SoCal UFO meetup group. This is like probably 10 years ago now. And I remember one night we were all meeting at Burger Continental in Pasadena. And lo and behold, Michael Shermer is there. I don't know if you know who he is.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And he's there, and
the number one.
And I asked him a question about 9/11, and he shut me down so quick. I was shocked. It was pretty inches, pretty funny. It was almost like I pissed him off.
I'm sure you did. Did you see that episode on Joe Rogan where they had Graham Hancock, Randall Carlson, and Michael Shermer all on at the same time? Yeah.
No, I'd like to see that.
Oh my God, it was the ultimate battle. Battle of the... the term slips my mind. But yeah, it was absolutely amazing. But here's the most amazing part is about 2 months ago, Michael Shermer, on his own accord, tweeted out to the public and admitted that... and I'm going to paraphrase here, but basically what he said was... turns out I might have to reconsider Graham Hancock's work after all.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Can you imagine him saying that? He actually did that.
No.
Yeah.
No, I'd be shocked.
Yeah, that actually happened 2 months ago. And absolutely amazing. But with that, ladies and gentlemen, We do. Oh, right on time, too. Look at me. Look at this. Doing things professionally. How about that? Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, GG, along with our guest and slash co-host of the night, JP from the Reperception Podcast. And yeah, man, and we'll be back here in just a few short minutes with, and we're going to open up the phone lines as well when we get back. Don't go anywhere. Tired of talking about the weather? No shift. Well, Shift Happens is here to fulfill your desires. As you reach that point in life where you crave tantalizing conversation about reality, ufology, the occult, and the conspiracies within, while simultaneously finding yourself desperately in need of your very own theme music, which we've got plenty of that too. So be sure to tune in to Shift Happens every Friday night from 7 to 9 Pacific, right here on The Fringe FM. Because the weather sucks, and you need some theme music.
Ever seen an extraterrestrial? It can be hard to believe they exist unless you've seen one for yourself. What if I told you I've seen them my whole life, but have never had a witness who shared the encounter with me? Now, what if I told you I saw four of them, two with blue skin, and there are over 20 witnesses to this CE5 event? My new book, The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, documents actual accounts from real witnesses, many of which have gone on record to attest to this otherworldly reality. Be a part of a quantum paradigm shift that is taking place right now. Go to johnpolkmedia.com to get your copy of The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, on sale right now at johnpolkmedia.com. That's johnpolkmedia.com.
This is Ronnie LeBlanc, author of Monsterland, Encounters with UFOs, Bigfoot, and Orange Orbs, and you're listening to Shift Happens on KTLK, The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting. We rock the paranormal talk.
For the Fringe FM, this is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our guest slash co-host of the evening, JP from the Reperception Podcast. All right, wait. JP, you're muted.
I'm sorry, I dropped the ball on that one. Hey, what? I'm here. I'm loving it. I like one-to-one with you. I like it with other guys. I miss you, Brad Harris.
Yeah. Absolutely. And you know what? You know what, JP? The reason why I asked you to come on the show is because since we don't do any of the same shows anymore, we never get to just hang out. So this was the perfect excuse to make you hang out with me.
I like it.
There you go. And again, we get asked this question almost every show. What is the name of that song? And yes, that is Misfit Love by Queens of the Stone Age. Yeah, it's a great song off of the Era Vulgaris record. You know what else is a great song? Is the actual song called Era Vulgaris. Even though, ultimately, at the end, they decided to leave the song Era Vulgaris off of the record that was titled Era Vulgaris. Yeah, think about that. in traditional Queens of the Stone Age fashion. Doesn't surprise anybody, really. And so there you go. The phone lines are open, ladies and gentlemen. If you guys want to call in, you can take this show wherever you want, folks. You can call in with anything. And the call-in number is 1-800-588-0335. And unlike all other radio hosts, I'm going to repeat the number again, so that you have time to write it down. The call-in number is 1-800-588-0335. Doesn't that ever blow your mind, JP, how, like, other hosts just... They'll just, like, 1-800-588-0 blah, 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 and just move on.
I don't know how they do it so fast.
Not only how do they say it so fast, but also, how does anybody call in? And IPD wants it for a third time. Okay, here you go. The call-in number is 1-800-588-0335. I've also posted it in both chat rooms. So there you go. Call in if you will. Call in if you dare. How about that? And speaking of call-ins, we actually have a surprise guest calling in, just in case you didn't hear me spoil that surprise at the beginning. Yeah, so hopefully a surprise special guest will be calling in a bit here. And so there you go. Now, I had a really good question for you, JP, that I was saving until right now. But guess what?
Nice. You forgot.
I totally forgot. Absolutely.
I was going to send you a video because you're such a Queens of the Stone Age fan. They played, not they, but... And I always forget his name. Michael, the bassist or guitarist.
Oh, Mikey Schumann, yeah.
Mikey Schumann. He played with my cousin's band, Sparks, about 4 years ago. He was touring with them on their Hippopotamus tour, and it's pretty awesome.
Dude, yeah. Mikey Schumann.
Of course they were.
Dude, Mikey Schumann, not only is he the same age as me, but not only is he the bass player for Queens, but and not only did he do that, but he also had his other band, Mini Mansions, which had two records.
And they are awesome.
Yes!
And that whole band, Mini Mansions, the whole band played, they recorded the Sparks last, they were basically Sparks' side band for almost 2 years.
And
it's pretty nuts. They all were like one band. So, yeah, my cousins know them very well, and I've met them all on several occasions. They're one of my favorite bands. I love them.
Dude, and not only all of those accolades, but also, you know, Grand Theft Auto V, obviously, right?
Yes.
Well, Mikey Schumann was one of the helped make so much of the music that was involved in that game. In fact, when you actually beat the story, one of the first names in the credits is Mikey Schumann.
I think I've seen an interview where he talks about that cool experience. making that soundtrack.
Yeah.
Apparently, that's where the good musicians are going. They're going to make video game music. Why not?
Listen, well, the music industry certainly isn't making any money. So, yeah, if you want to make money doing music, you got to do it for video games or movies or something.
Times have certainly changed. And, man, I look back at, like, for example, just, you know, Sparks, my cousin's band. I look back at their discography, and it literally blows me away, because their first album as Sparks was released the year I was born, and almost every year, basically, not every year, but at least 20 different years occasions, they've released new albums. So
yeah.
It's pretty awesome. I think they have 24 studio albums they've released from then till now. And so I look at that, and it's like impossible. You'll never see that again. There's not going to be bands that are around for 30 or 40 whatever years. I'm not going to tell
you. Well, I'll give you a close runner up. Do you know who that is?
There are a few, but Chumbawamba is one of them.
That's what I was going to say. 19 records, 30 yeah. years.
Yes, they've been around. I knew you were going to go there. Yeah, that's, to me, used to be so important. Longevity in music used to be so important to me. By the way, I think Smashing Pumpkins just released a new album, and I'm not going to buy it.
I was going to say, they should probably just stop, you know? At this
just
point...
Just witches again.
Or at least do a different project. Don't drag the Smashing Pumpkins legacy into the ground. I mean, don't get me wrong. I have not heard the new stuff, so I'm not going to be...
It sounds okay.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure it's all right. But, man, let's just face it.
Well, look, I'm all for bands aging and releasing new music and taking chances. That's what Sparks have always done. They're not afraid to take chances. A lot of bands that have done stuff like we were saying, like old bands that are still making music or release music, like 30 albums or whatever they did, or 20 albums over 30 years. You know, I'm all for it. Like, they should do it, but just not in a cheesy way. And I think a lot of bands, like the Rolling Stones, they just, you know what to expect on a new Rolling Stones album.
Right.
Like, you're not going to get anything too nutty.
There's such a nuance there in that point that I won't even get into right now. But Willie does say in the chat, Smashing Pumpkins, one of the greatest bands of all times. Yes, you are right, Willie. They certainly are. But what my point is that they should have quit while they were still the best. You know what I mean? Like, what really bothers me is when bands milk it to the very dry nipple of the end. Like, that's what really bothers me. Like, listen, once you stop sounding like what you're known for, you might as well call it something else. Unless you establish from the very beginning that you are always going to give you something different, like Queens of the Stone Age. Every
exactly.
single record is completely different, and
exactly.
every single record doesn't sound like anything you've ever heard before. Now, if you're doing that, then yes, you can keep going. But if you're trying to reinvent the wheel 30 years later for the 30th time, just call it something else. Don't ruin your legacy.
Like Pisces is, I don't even know how to say it, but Smashing Pumpkins, I think their first release was so good that, I mean, it's still one of my favorite albums ever, but I don't want to hear a new album by them where they're singing about witches. I just don't.
Yeah. And, and now I do have, so now Willie says in the chat room here, he says they didn't milk Shift. They experimented with different sounds, but they stayed true to their core. And I hope they did. I hope they did. And I'm going to be honest, I have not heard their new stuff. I'm just saying that they're within that time range of being around long enough to where it could go south pretty quickly if they don't really, you know, stick to what made them Smashing Pumpkins in the first place. And you'd be surprised at how quickly even the biggest bands forget who they actually are. And there's nothing more sad than that to me.
I wonder if Willie is like me, and back when the reason why he likes Smashing Pumpkins so much is when they were at their peak or on their way up towards their peak. I don't know. I seem to be like, that was like the best. I liked going on dates and playing Smashing Pumpkins songs on dates. I don't know why.
Oh, it's
I wonder
great
if Willie
date
had
music.
That
yeah.
same experience.
Oh yeah, it's great. Yeah, they have some great date jams. Absolutely, absolutely. And you know what's funny is so the dude that we had on, Dambert No Bacon from Chumbawamba, they had a very famous song that they did, which was him pretending to be Billy Corgan on stage because he looked like Billy Corgan, and he would dress up like him and do this whole act, and it was pretty funny, but. But yeah, the Smashing Pumpkins, I mean, don't get me wrong, Willie, or anybody else, the Smashing Pumpkins had some great hits. But there's just some, there's, like, for example, I'm going to give you a good analogy here. In the professional skateboarding world, I'm going to compare two professional skateboarders here. Heath Kurtchart compared to Ed Templeton. They were both on top of their shift, the top of their game back when they were primetime pro skateboarders, right? The only difference is Ed Templeton they both made a huge name for themselves. Whereas Ed Templeton decided to milk it, even though he got old and even though his tricks weren't as good and everybody could see, it got to a point where everybody started making fun of him for milking it for so long. Whereas Heath Kurtchart, same age, had the same amount of success, but instead of milking it for 30 years, he just killed it for 15 and then retired at the top of his game. And that is how I think it's done. You need to know when to quit. You need to know when to stop.
I like what you said, though, man. The caveat there is if you establish yourself as being able, whatever it is, extreme sports, even politics, or music, if come out the gates showing that you're ready to mix it up each time, every time new album, you're not gonna look backwards. You might bring forward a few of the tricks and the sound that got you there, but everything else is gonna be completely you're gonna try for uncharted territory within your bounds. And the great bands do that. And sadly, there's very few that, you know, make it, you know, in that sort of way. Most of them become predictable in talking about bands. Certainly politicians, they're almost every time letdowns. You know, you just take a look through all these areas where people have the potential and can really give people something different each and every time. Instead, they rest on their laurels, get lazy, suck it, and then go too far to get the money every time out. And all right, well, cash in your chips, but just get the hell out of my way. I'm sick of that.
Yeah. Man, I feel you 100%. Let's see, another good one, IPD. And Kat says, you quit at the top and then you just go to Vegas. Exactly. That's what you do. You make your 20 million and then you put 20 million on red on the roulette table and then you double that to 40 million and then you walk out. That's how you do it. Listen, folks, do not take gambling advice from me. Please do not. But that is my advice. If you're going to make $20 million, that's what you do with it. Well, maybe take $10 million. Just take half. Put that on red and double that. Yeah. There you go. There you go. Elvis. I don't know. What do you think about Elvis, JP?
I loved Elvis. Loved Elvis. You know. See, I mean, I don't know what you mean. besides his music, or just as his, when I look back at his whole catalog or what he was about?
Well, it would just be nice if Elvis actually wrote his own music. You know what I mean? Like, it's kind of hard for me to get into something that he didn't even make, you know?
Gigi, don't set me down the trail of music.
Oh, are we doing this?
The psychological operation that it is.
Are we doing this?
We're not gonna go there.
Okay, let's do it. We're already in it. I'm just kidding, but...
We could do that, but you know what? I think that's a show for another night. McGowan, yeah. By the way, has a great book on the history of Laurel Canyon. If you want the real deep dive into Laurel Canyon and the music scene that started music in a different direction when it did in the 60s, go check out, go look into those ideas. And man, I forgot his first name, but McGowan has a great online presence, I think, in a book about Laurel Canyon. But yeah, there's, come on, man, Elvis and especially in the Beatles, the timing of the Beatles was insane right after the America was in a deep depression because of the death of JFK, and then along comes the Beatles. Yeah. And anyways, I'm not going to go down this road, but
yeah, well, I'll take one foot in and say that, see here, and Kat says it the best. He was a performer.
Yes.
Elvis was. Yes, he was a performer, but he was not an artist. He did not write his own songs. He didn't even coordinate his own dances. People told him what to do. And that's the difference, is because, yes, don't get me wrong, it's fantastic. I love Elvis. I love everything he did. But when it comes to someone like Josh Homme, who not only does all of that, but he wrote and created it himself. Now that's impressive.
That's true artistry, and that shines through in the music. And Elvis was a strange beast because, I mean, think about like how famous he was. He if he didn't write it, he owned it. You know what I mean? Like, he was great. He was an interesting character in this world,
for sure.
Like Michael Jackson.
Yeah, and listen, think what you will about Michael Jackson, people, but Thriller. Just think about that. Thriller in the night. Girl, let me hold you tight and shout out. Thriller, Thriller. Ow! Bow, 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 bow. Just that bass line right there. And but you know what else is, Michael Jackson at least actually helped write the fucking, oh my god, I said an F-bomb. Oh my lord, Joe, please forgive me. I'm so sorry. I can't believe I did that either. But listen, folks, Thriller, Michael Jackson actually helped write that too. And not to mention Russ Bailey, laughing in the chat room, would probably appreciate this more than most of our audience, Sonic the Hedgehog 3 and Sonic and Knuckles, therefore, which came out on the Sega Genesis, that soundtrack was actually, Michael Jackson actually wrote a lot of that tune, a lot of those tunes, but there was some sort of secret exclusivity contract to where nobody was allowed to know that until he died. So after he died, back, what was that, 2010? Wait, no, that must have been 2009, right? I think. Yeah. But either way, so after he died, it was announced to everyone that, yes, in fact, he did work on the music for Sonic the Hedgehog 3. On the Genesis and Sonic and Knuckles, which is basically two games in one, or one game that was separated into two, rather, is probably the best way to put it. Now let me double check and make sure. Yep, no, we're good. And did I give out the wrong? Yeah, I don't know. No, I think I did.
You people should be calling in.
That's one thing I've noticed, man, is. Most people that listen to these shows, they're not like you and what I'm trying to say is you and me have a bug for talking to people and just talking and just hanging out and talking. Like we're very social people.
All day long.
But I've noticed that most of the audience, it's not that they don't want to call in. It's just that they just want to hear the show.
You know? I'm cool with that.
And, yeah. And there's nothing wrong with that at all. But I do want to make you guys aware that, listen, don't be shy. Like, if you want to call in, we will take your call, and you can hang out as long as you want. And I feel like I've made that pretty clear.
If you don't mind, Gigi, two things I'd like to do before the show ends. And one is I really want to get into the idea of the social credit ratings that are in place right now, going on in China, and there's some evidence it might maybe happening here, at least starting to. And anyways, hopefully we can talk about that for a minute when we get back from the break. But also at the very end of the show, if we have time, I was going to give a quick, simple, basic recipe for a couple spagyric formulas that I make. And I just want to, maybe I could run down the steps, quick and easy steps. And I figure, you know, if somebody out there was interested in tinctures and learning about making them, this might be an interesting, aspect. If you don't mind, if we have time.
Yeah, no, we'll get into both of those things. And in fact, in order to do so, let's just go ahead and take this break a couple of minutes early. So with that said, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our break a couple of minutes early. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our guest tonight, JP from the Repercession Podcast. And we'll be back here in just a few short, minutely, Hadouken minutes. Don't go anywhere. But I've got a secret I cannot say. They might have moved
that to give it away. You've got some... You can tug all day long on a carpet that's been glued to the floor. Then you hurt. There are many strong glues out there. Let's see, there's liquid nails and Gorilla Glue. You ever try to remove 3M 5200? That adhesive is strong. Then there's bathroom caulk, silicone rubber, adhesive tape, super glue, flex tape, and stickers. Graffiti! Scientists have come up with glues that stay stuck and can't be removed. Until now. Until Handyman Formula by DeBond. That's right, 95% of adhesives become unstuck when you spray Handyman Formula directly on them. Just spray, wait a few minutes, and remove. It's amazing. Most adhesives become unstuck when you use Handyman Formula. Visit DeBondCorporation.com or MCMaster.com. Call 561-575-4200. This stuff really works. Handyman Formula by DeBond, a great Christmas gift.
Are you intrigued by Paranormal Talk Radio? You'll love the new Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live. You'll find a great selection of talk shows covering UFOs, ghosts, strange phenomena, and much more. Download the Paranormal Radio app now and start listening to the very best in paranormal talk entertainment, including the network you're listening to right now, the Paranormal Radio app, free in Google Play and the iOS App Store.
All right, man, this is Crow 777, and you are listening to The Fringe FM.
So, you love talk radio? Then you'll love TalkStreamLive.com. TalkStream Live is always on, 24/7, with the best streaming talk shows. Find your favorite talkers and discover some new ones. It's free, readily available online or on mobile with any smartphone or tablet. Finding your favorite talk shows all in one place has gotten a whole lot easier. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com. Be sure to download the free apps from Google Play or the iTunes App Store.
Want to know what's on The Fringe FM? Check out our schedule at thefringe.fm.
Don't feed the archons. Feed ducks instead. And listen to Shift Happens on The Fringe FM. Fridays, 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific. Cortana out. Quack.
Okay, nurse, let's get this man to the ER stat.
Right away, doctor.
We see this every day. Heart attack or angina pain due to blocked and clogged arteries. Chelation can remove obstructions or blockages from arteries and help avoid painful and expensive surgery. Now there's Angioprim. It's a liquid oral chelation product that you take with juice. You start to feel the results fast. Angioprim increases blood flow all over the body, and that means more energy and strength to take on the day with less aches and pains. 60 years of research has gone into chelation. And Angioprim is the result, a safe and easy way to unblock your veins and arteries from buildup that slow circulation.
Paging Dr. Jones, please report to the emergency room right away.
Log on now for a special radio offer from Angioprim. That's angioprim.com/radio. A-N-G-I-O-P-R-I-M. Angioprim.com/radio or call 877-882-7221. That's 877-882-7221.
Live for 3 hours every Saturday night. It's a show that engages the mind, makes you think, and maybe even challenge what you think you know. Hi, I'm Jeremy Scott of Into the Paranormal, where we talk about topics that are anything but mainstream, somewhere between abnormal and paranormal. Bring an open mind and join us for Into the Paranormal, live Saturdays at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern on The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting, TheFringe.fm, Napa Valley, California, Little Rock, Arkansas.
This is Tom Sherman. Down here at Banning College, we're promoting a blood drop.
Oh, shit.
Not guilty.
Welcome to the sound of America. It was like the AM 580. Lay back, the sheep, little lamb.
Adam the apple.
Throw me so to my base!
You cannot be saved.
Follow me and I will.
Good to know that he's walking with me.
Big rock is a weapon.
The devil is a black dog.
Into the fog.
Let him cast the first.
Jesus.
And you have fallen into the love that needs to be discerned by the Lord. Hallelujah, y'all. I want to hear a couple of hallelujahs.
That didn't sound out. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to The Fringe FM. This is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our guest for the evening, JP from the Reperception Podcast. Oh, JP, you're muted again.
Yeah, I keep going to that. But I'm
Well, you know what? I would rather you mute and then forget to unmute than the other guest who forget to mute in the first place. So, yeah, at least you have that going. And
I was a little gassy during the last segment, so I definitely had to use the mute button.
Yeah, you gotta squeeze that out when you can, you know? Yeah. You gotta have that mute button ready. And also, so Hal Fry says in the chat room, JP, miss you, buddy.
Hey, what's up, man? I thought he was gonna call in.
Well, he wanted to, but he might not be able to. But we'll see. And our other call-inner has also not called in, so... But you know what? That's...
He has a question.
Oh, who does? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He probably will. In fact, especially if he's been listening to the whole show. And now I do want to point out that I have a feeling that people in our chat rooms are taking Willie a little bit too seriously. How do we want to point this out, JP?
Well, I just kind of summarized it. Willie believes that we are living in a simulation, and he's also in love with a meth Eskimo.
Yeah, so that... Listen, folks, if there's one sure sign that you're doing something wrong in life, you know what? I'm not going to finish that sentence. How about that?
People who don't know what a Eskimo is, just avoid them the rest of your life. It's all you need to know.
Especially if you know what that is. Yeah. God bless us all. Ladies and gentlemen, God bless us all.
Glad he's here.
God bless us all.
Yes. This coffee, by the way, I never knew hemp and coffee together. I didn't know that was a thing.
Yeah, no, it's and but you know now, and it's very awesome. I can't believe I never sent you any. We'll have to send you some. Oh, I mean, you're drinking that right now, aren't you?
That's what I have now.
Yeah,
but only a sample. I need more. I need more. Definitely.
Yes, you need more. That's what it is. That's what it is.
I'm out. Now I'm out.
Oh man.
Yes. Yes. It's a great chat room tonight. I'm glad. Oh wow. Kind of catching up.
Yeah, it's been a great chat room all night, and speaking of great, great music all night, including the song that's playing right now, if you are not banging your head, you are banned forever from Shift Happens. Yeah!
I can't believe I haven't ordered my Shift Happens shirt yet. I'm going to totally do that. Oh my god, I'm way behind.
Wait,
but those are great pictures by the Elf.
Wait a minute. Oh, yes. Thank you, Elf, for sending those pictures. But wait, did we not send you a shirt, dude?
You know what? I was on me. I screwed up. I meant to contact Brad. And...
Okay, well, how about this? What size shirt do you wear?
I'm an XL.
I've got one XL left. Are you ready for it?
Yeah, but I'm not looking for a handout. I'll buy one. I know these things cost money.
No, you don't buy anything. No. I'm going to give it to you. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Hell yeah, yeah. Dude. I was wondering what I was going to do with that last XL. But don't worry, folks. Oh, and look, ladies and gentlemen, we have a surprise special guest joining the show just as long as Skype decides to work, which it probably won't, although it actually did.
At
Holy Moses.
The Kraken.
Ladies and gentlemen.
That's good.
Hal Fry, what's happening, my friend?
It's Hal Fry.
JP, you're in a winter wonderland, I see. That's awesome.
Yeah.
It's very flowy out here.
Just driving through.
Checking out the scenery and keeping it light. How about you? What have you been up to? And have we said anything that has maybe sparked some sort of debate in your mind, or do you have any
any sort of interest at all?
I don't have any questions. Unfortunately, I just started tuning in after this last break, so I have no idea what y'all said.
That's fine, because you can just sit here and hang out with us as we manhandle the rest of the show. How about that?
That's fine.
And I'm not sure what I meant by that. But
I don't either.
Yeah, I really don't know what I meant by that. But surely it meant something powerful. That's what I imagined when I said it. And with that, let's see. Man, you know what? Like I said, listen, we're looking for interns, folks. We need somebody to manage these chat rooms. This is preposterous. And no, it's not a replay, Sammy. We are live. We are live right here on the Fringe FM. Actually, I don't know. Maybe
that question was incredibly well timed, since this was recorded about 3 years ago. How did he know to ask? That's crazy. It all happened right now. Wow.
Yeah, there you go. And so, Sean, how about this? Since we have you on the phone, and by Sean I mean Hal Fry, what is like? Well, you missed the earlier part of the show, so let me rephrase this. What is the one mystery about this crazy reality that we find ourselves in that you have just never heard a good answer for? I know it's a loaded question, but I know you can handle it. I wouldn't ask you otherwise.
So wait, what's the question again?
How dare you?
It can be rephrased, maybe.
Let me hear JP say it.
Yeah, JP, okay. You asked the question.
So some things haven't fully been solved in our history. I think we use the example of Egypt and the pyramids.
Indeed.
People are still kind of debating, and we had a little debate earlier. You probably missed that. And then I also threw in JFK, which, you know, seems that people are still, you know, just at odds about certain things. And I've been saying for a long time that it was, I mean, who cares? We're asking you, but I forgot to add this in when we were talking about it, Gigi, for the record, that the JFK event was a complete hoax. So,
obviously.
And I will explain that another day, but anyways, it's a debate. It's still open. People don't know. Is there anything in our history that when you look back and think about it, is, you know, what would you consider to be one of those mysteries that still is unsolved?
And just to add on top of that, one of those mysteries being something that we were told that was solved, but in fact, it really was not. That's really
okay. I got one, Ralph. The Big Bang Theory.
Yes. Ooh. Wow. Yeah. Good point.
Because no one knows how we got here.
Yeah, that's like the odds of someone actually explaining how the Big Bang happened is the same odds of me trying to specifically point out which bird specifically took a shift on my car. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I know it was a bird, right? But I don't know which bird it was, you know? How the hell would I know?
How would you know?
You wouldn't. That's my point. Just in the same way as the Big Bang Theory, because here's the thing about the Big Bang Theory, and in fact, one of the few points that my father actually relates to this stuff that we do on the show is the Big Bang Theory. And his whole kind of quandary is, well, I mean, it had to start somewhere, right? But if it started, then that means that there had to have been something before. But yet we're kind of just told this story of there was nothing before. Well, wait a minute. That doesn't... How do you get something out of nothing? It's kind of what it really gets down to.
Yeah.
Unless you're just not following me whatsoever.
I was walk down this really quick because we're running a little bit low on time. I think it's important. And I just wanted to see if either of you have any opinion or have heard anything about this social credit ranking. And in China right now, there was recently, in the last couple years, They had problems with their AI and identifying people. And so what they did, because in Asia, there's a lot less variances in the looks, a lot of dark hair and similar facial features and everything. So, you know, it's very hard for the AI to decipher. So what they had set up is a bunch of kiosks throughout China set up, and they were offering people to pay them money. They pay their bills for simply smiling into a camera and taking a picture for them. And this was wildly popular. Of course, a lot of people in China did this. And what that did, and what I'm told and from what I've read, within 72 hours, the AI was able then to identify most of the variances in the Chinese people, because they needed the micro expression. And by getting this massive amount of people to smile into the camera and take the picture, they were able to get their AI rolling. And this was a very huge tie-in for the social credit rankings, which they now have. And so here's one example of how the social credit ranking is actually working in China right now. And so, you know, here, I don't know if in your cities there are the bikes that you can, you know, put your credit card on and borrow and ride them through the city for however many minutes you pay for. Well, in China, they also have these bikes too everywhere. And with the social credit rankings, if you have a very high credit ranking, you could pick up those bikes and you can ride all day long and you don't have to pay. Now, if your credit is at a medium level, then you might be able to get the bike. I think it's for like 2 hours, but you have to pay for it too. So you can't keep it all day. You have a limited amount of time and you have to pay. And imagine this, if you had a crappy, shifty social credit ranking, you cannot even rent those bikes right now. And, you know, it affects a whole bunch of different layers of how the social hierarchy is being run over there right now, like dating sites and the availability of loans where the interest rates are super high. The worse your credit, social credit rankings are. It's just crazy. And I'm just wondering if, Gigi, maybe you had heard any of this sort of thing.
I've heard about it.
Yeah, I think we all have, really. And that's just a natural result of the way society has manifested, I guess. Like, how would you not get that? You know, how would someone not take that position, given how everything has unfolded? If that, I know that sounds very vague, but surely somebody knows what I mean.
Yeah, no, I get it.
I think if I was a person there and I was like, man, this is some bullshit.
Yeah.
If I came to that conclusion, then I would try my hardest not to participate in it and just make my way and get the F out of that country. As hard as I could.
Well, now you see why it was started, initiated there in a communist country.
Yeah.
For that very reason.
At the same time, if I grew up there, then I would have like a totally different mindset, I would imagine. So I can't really say, like, I guess what I'm saying, if I was a person who grew up there and I came across the information I needed to know that it was bullshit, and then would take steps to get out of there or avoid it.
Nice. And Gigi, you mentioned something interesting. You said it was a natural sort of evolution, and dang, man, you just opened the freaking doors on something. But it's where I wanted to go tonight. It was all about this idea of Darwin and evolution. And oh, man, there's no way there's enough time
to
budge into that.
Well, that's why we have you on the show, is because now, at this point, if people want to further investigate into these areas, well, ladies and gentlemen, there's no better place to go than to the Reperception podcast over there at reperception.net, which is your website, correct?
Yes, yeah, check it out. It's I'm building it, but the blog's going. I'm blogging a lot on there, so definitely go check out Reperception. Thank you.
Reperception.net.
Yeah, for sure, man. And like I said, folks, I've worked with JP on so many different occasions on this show and that show and another show and that show and that show's step cousin's nephew show that he had a show too. You know, we've done it all. We've done it all. And like I said before, I mean, for one, I just wanted an excuse to hang out with you, right?
Thank you.
But then for two, I really think, you know, I'm going to go on a little bit of a, you know, no bromo, but straight up, dude, you actually, out of all of the people that I know that do radio shows, the thing I respect about you the most is that you have zero F's given about what people think of your opinion, and you just straight up do your own research and you come to very realistic, very real conclusions, and you have a very different perspective from most people that, for one, that I subscribe to. I will personally vouch for JP right here on the show. I agree with about 98% of everything he says. And listen, folks, if you do not listen to the Reperception podcast, you are missing out. Go to reperception.net, spelled exactly how it sounds, reperception.net, and go check out his show. And just do it. Just do it. Just do
Gigi,
it.
When's your birthday? Like what date? Not the year, but what day?
Well, it was on September 25th.
Oh, you just passed it.
Now, yeah.
Did you eat cake? Did you have a birthday cake?
Not so much a cake, but I did buy a pecan pie.
Hey, nice. A pie is better than cake. Trust me. Hal Fry, do you know what the Greek word is for cake?
No.
It's placenta.
Oh, and I thought it was pecan pie.
We're going to go through the whole story of evolution, and we're going to talk about Darwin. We're going to talk about evolution. We're going to talk about fertilization. We're going to know when I ask you what is your origin, I am going to make sure you all know the right answer, because there is a right answer. Trust me on this. There is. And if you know your origin, you may never eat another cake the rest of your life. I'm just saying. Anyways, I didn't want to go too deep or too vague, but I did.
You know, that,
you pushed me, man.
That was perfect. And but you know what? We are actually at the end of the show somehow. Isn't that crazy how the time just sort of flies and all of a sudden we're here?
We still have some time. We still have a couple minutes.
We do, but the only problem is whenever I do think we have a couple of minutes, we actually don't, and I take way too long to end the show. So I'm going to go ahead.
Did you get any answers to your question about what people thought was the best thing they ate at Thanksgiving? Hal Fry maybe can answer.
You know what? We have a lot of chats, but nobody really answered that question. One person did. One person did, and I forgot what he... Dude, that was like an hour and a half ago. I would have to scroll back so far to find that. But good Lord, whoever did answer that question, God bless you. And but listen, ladies and gentlemen, so real quick, I know we just gave you the biggest shout out ever, but real quick, before we go, JP, where can everyone keep up with everything that is the one and only Jew Pro?
Well, I'm going to come back and do this show. I have a real serious show I want to do with you guys at some point, but you can, I have a, you know, YouTube, you know, Reperception on YouTube, and then my website. So you hit it. Thank you. I appreciate that.
There you go. And all the links are over there at the website, shifthappensradio.com. Go to the upcoming page and you'll see all the links over there. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we got to get the hell on out of here. This show has been hosted and produced by yours truly, Gigi. You can follow me on Twitter at GigiRabbit1. And more importantly, you can follow the show over at Shift Happens Pod over there on Twitter. Now, if you go to shifthappensradio.com, you'll get all the links to all of our Facebooks and Instagrams and all of our interweb stuffs. All of our interweb stuffs is all over there. Special thanks again to JP for coming on tonight, and special thanks to Hal Fry for coming on tonight as well. Another special shout out to our rummy reporter, Eric Awakening Man.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
As well as Dennis Koch for all the promotional goodness that he does. And thanks for tuning in, folks. But don't go too far, because coming up next right here on The Fringe FM is Lighting the Void with Joe Mother Bleepin' Broom. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll see you next weekend. Or next Friday, rather. Anyway, take care. Enjoy the rest of your leftovers. And we'll see you next week. Cheers to ya! Oh, and wave bye-bye.